Cool. So, today I will talk about open source hardware in industrial use. And I will try to convince you that open source hardware and industrial electronics are a pretty good match. Who am I? My name is Tsvetan Usunov. I am from Olimex. We are a small company in Bulgaria. We do electronic design, different electronic devices, and all our products are designed and built in Bulgaria, in Plovdiv. And many of them are with open source hardware license and certified by the Open Source Hardware Association. So, what is open source hardware? I always begin my talks about open source hardware with the definition. And you will see later why I do this. Open Source Hardware Association has a definition what exactly is open source hardware, because different people before this definition has been interpreting what is open, what is closed in many different ways. So to stop all this speculation, Open Source Hardware Association made a definition when it clearly says open source hardware is this hardware which you can learn from it, study, modify, even sell it, and all the sources has to be in such format so people can modify it. So if you just publish your schematic in JPEG format, this is okay. The people can see what is inside, but they cannot modify it. They cannot sell it, so it's not open source hardware. So how we benefit from the open source hardware? For me, the first is, and more important, most important, is that we share our knowledge. We share what we know. If we look back human history, most of achievements in the science, in the biology, in the sociology, are made for the last 300 years. And why? Did we got smarter? Did we got bigger brains or something like this? No. People are same 1,000 years. For 1,000 years, but what happened? 500 years ago, Gutenberg invented easy way to print the books. So people can store their knowledge in the books. We know we have books for many 1,000 years, but it was just for the elite. To make book was very hard. People draw with special skills, draw these pictures in the books for years. And they was very expensive. It's too not too many people have access to this knowledge. And what happened? In 200 years, these books become so cheap that more and more people can start read and get this knowledge. So they could collaborate better. And this is what happens now, 30 years ago. We got even more powerful tool to share our knowledge, internet. So people now can collaborate all around the world in same project, and this actually made the bust for all open source project. If you see, 30 years ago, there was not so many open source project, but now, since we have the internet, the tool to exchange our knowledge very fast and very efficient, we got tons of open source hardware, open source software, and this is what accelerate the way we achieve our knowledge. So I think open source hardware and software, they have very special place for the human developments, for all these achievements in the future. You see this maker movement, it changed everything. It changed a lot of people who was not interested in technology, in electronics. Now they are not afraid to use it because it's approachable. You have tools, you can design your PCBs, and you don't have to pay a big money to have tools for the designing the PCBs. And this is how all these open source hardware projects start to flourish. Then, the second thing is, with the open source, we can show what we can. There is no better way to show your capability than to make open source project, because everything is open. People can open your repository and to see what you have done, what is your track record. I run Olimex for almost 30 years. And let's say 20 years ago, when I had new customer, he has come to us, inspect everything, and said, give me a reference for your customers. Let's see what you have done. Now they don't ask these questions. Why? Because we put everything on internet so they can check and see what we can do. Building community is very essential for making a product, even not open source product, especially for the open source project. But Raspberry Pi is not open source project, but they have huge community. So they benefit from this. Every product which attracts bigger community is more successful. What made, for instance, Espressif system successful? Because they had so low price first that a lot of people start to design with their boards. And now there is a Realtek, there is a Qualcomm, there is a huge giants which can produce cheaper boards than them. But you have to be very, very different in the pricing to attract some community. Because before Espressif was not the first company which made the Wi-Fi chips. Texas Instruments made this maybe 5 years before them. But the Texas Instruments board cost something like $30. And then Espressif Systems come and made the board for $3. This is 10 times difference. This is huge motivation people to start learning your product and to use it. Now, Realtek and Qualcomm, they also make a Wi-Fi board which has a lot of more future. They have more memory, faster processor, better stacks, dual Wi-Fi support. But they cost again $3. So people say, why should I learn new technology when I already have existing technology which work for me and I have huge community, I can ask questions, get help. If they offer their new chips for 30 cents, that will make sense. Everybody will say, yeah, but I will have a huge savings if my project is successful and I start making. But it's not so easy to offer 30 cents Wi-Fi chip now. So Espressif got the right place, the right product with the right pricing and attracted huge community. If you search Google Trends, they are now more popular than Arduino. So building community is very essential to project to be successful. Open source hardware benefits that you get free feedback for everything, for all your failures, all the things you didn't see when you designed your board. And we had a discussion yesterday about RISC-V computers and so on. And the guy was asking me, okay, but how you can prove that they release the Verilog files and they put the same thing in the chip? They might say, this is the Verilog file, but to put in the chip something different. And I say, yeah, I don't know this, but I'm sure there will be someone, if this is open, he will verify it because he has the tools, he has the knowledge for this. It's same with the Linux drivers. I'm not expert. I use Linux, but I believe that there are more capable than me people who can verify if there is a hidden backdoors and everything works like it should. So getting this feedback is also something which every open source project is benefiting. And it gains the confidence that you don't hide anything from your customers. And of course, the most important is collaboration. And because of this feedback, you make better products. You don't benefit only you from the open source. Your component suppliers also benefit from this, and the most obvious is Allwinner. We start using Allwinner chips. Why? Because there was Linux SUNXI community, which was very user-friendly, and if we have some problem with our boards, we can ask questions and get feedback from the community. And we start to release open source hardware with Allwinner chips, and people start to make different boards based on our project. So Allwinner is selling this, for instance, 820 chips already for 6 or 7 years. This is something they never did before. Last March, they come to us in Olimex and they said, we never expect that we can sell chips so long time. Why these people keep buying this technology? This is because they use it to be in the consumer market. And then you have lifetime for your product, maximum 1 year. After 1 year, this chip is already obsolete. There is somebody with more cores, with more memories, with more features, and they have to run. And what they sell for 1 year, that's it. Then the new chip is coming. Now, 8 years later, nobody makes tablets with 820. Nobody uses 820 for TV boxes and things like this. But people put them in the projects, in industrial projects, in other projects, and they don't want to change their design every year because they made a product, they made a certification, which costs a lot of money, and they want to produce it as long as possible without any change because every change costs money. And this is how the suppliers benefit from the open source technologies. When you make your technology open, many people start to produce derivative products with it, and the supplier sell the chips for longer time. Some suppliers found this, and we got emails like, can you put our chip in your next product? We will give you free issue. Tell me what number of chips you want. Because a lot of people just copy. They don't change anything. And what we put in the design, they're just copy. And they see a sales opportunity for this, and they say, use our chips, and we will give it free of charge, but put it in your design. Of course, we don't do this because it will not work in the long term. Why people like open source hardware? Because even people who don't make open source hardware, they like to learn. And there is no better way to learn how something works if you just see how somebody else already did it. So this starts to become a marketing tool. People see, people love open source hardware. Let's make and pretend that our product is also open source. So you can see a lot of boards which are called open spec, running open source, and blah, blah, blah. They want to have open in their name, but basically they are not open source. And this is where Open Source Hardware Association did a great job, because if somebody say, my product is open, you say, give me your certificate, and let me see if it passed the certification, because there is a clear definition what you have to publish, and non-conditionally, because there is tons of Kickstarter products which say, our product is open source, we will open it after we sell 1,000 pieces. Okay, go and certify this with the Open Source Hardware Association, and we will accept that it is open source. They say there has to be no conditions, no registrations, no give me your email and I will give you the files. No, you have to publish it, and everybody has to be able to download it, study, modify, sell. If you don't do this, you're not open source. How the customers benefit from the open source? It's obvious. They have no vendor dependence. Why? Because everything is there. And if, for instance, Olimex tomorrow closes, they have all the full documentation. So they can manufacture by themselves or just pay somebody to manufacture it for them. And this pushes the prices low. You cannot charge unreasonable amounts of money, because everybody can compete with you. You can see what happened with Arduino. It started with $30 board for just one processor. Now the internet is flooded with boards for $1, $2, $3. Why? Because it's open source, and who can manufacture more efficiently will sell it. And maybe Arduino team now sells one per 100 sold boards. I don't know the statistics, but I assume, because you must be crazy to pay $30 when you get 10 boards for the same amount. Of course, if you don't want to support the project to move on and to keep the development works. And this leads to long-term availability. I told you how it works for the SOC vendors. They sell more chips, and they even cannot figure out what happens with this chip, why we do sell him so well. And you give to your customers longer availability because of this. Many people use this product. The SOC vendor has motive to keep producing it, so people benefit from longer delivery availability. And you have security for your business because you have full control on the documentation, on everything, on this process, on this product. Open source hardware allow easy customization. This means if you don't like something, you have the files. Change what you don't like and make your own product. And just imagine if you can do this with commercial closed source. I don't like the microphone on my iPhone. I have to change it. No, you can't, because you don't have any idea what is inside, how it's made. Or I want to remove the part which spies on me. No, you cannot, because you don't have. You cannot customize closed source products. Another benefit is that the customers can collaborate with you. We have some products which has 12, 15 revisions. This is really hell. But why we do it? Because we get a very valuable feedback. And they say, if you make this inside your product, it will become better. And we start to thinking and say, yes, he's right. We have to change this. And we make a new revision of the board. So customers suggest us something to do. And if we find it reasonable, we do it. Guess how it will work if you have a closed source product and you say to Microsoft, for instance, make the Surface laptop with some different screen or different keyboard or add this feature. It will be not possible. And at the end of the day, the customer receives a better product. What the industrial customers want. First, they need reliable operation 24/7 because most of these industrial applications, they run machines. And if this machine fail, it costs a lot of money or it might even cost human life. So reliable operation is first requirement if you want to do something industrial. Then they need long-term supply. Why? Because when you make an industrial machine, you have to certify a lot of standards. You have to meet a lot of standards. And then once it is certified, you cannot touch anything. Or you have to pay again for all this certification. We have one customer who is making huge motor power electronic drivers. They are big like this room, and they are powering motors for oil platforms, gas pumping station, conveyors. And we released IMX 233 board back 12 years ago. And that was our first open source Linuxino board. ARM 9 core, 64 megabyte of RAM, total nonsense in nowadays. But we have this customer who is buying thousands of boards every year, and they don't want to touch it. And because Freescale had 10 years supply program for this, and they started manufacturing 2008. 2018, they said, it's your last time buy. Decide what quantity you want to buy because we will not manufacture this anymore. Nobody wants it. And it was costing something like €6 more than double core, 1.2 gigahertz, Cortex. And I asked our customers, what is your forecast? We want it forever. I said, no, we just give me some number. And he said, okay, get the 10K units. We will try to implement something meanwhile. So we can continue for at least 2 or 3 years more to supply these boards for him. And he will change his design because Freescale doesn't produce this processor anymore. It runs Linux kernel 2.6 or 2.8. But they don't touch it. They said this is our connectivity board, and everything is done with this board, and we don't change the specs. So long-term supply is very important decision maker when somebody is in industrial business. White operating temperature. This is, of course, again, related to the reliable operation. These machines generate a lot of noise. It's a huge current which passes through this board, so you have to be noise immune. You have to operate in harsh environment, white temperature from minus to plus, because it works outside. And what other people from the industry want is old revision of the boards, because they certified their product with revision G. Now we make already revision K, but they say, no, I don't need it. It works for me. I want to buy revision G. We do this for them because there is no problem. We have all the documentation, everything. So if they say, I want revision G, okay, we can make the revision G. But it is with this and this and this bug. I don't care. It works in our device. We don't want to change. Something happens a few months ago when Raspberry Pi changed revision Raspberry Pi 3 to Raspberry Pi 4. Suddenly, we start to get a lot of orders for smallish companies for 100, 200, and I start to asking why. And he said, they switched to Raspberry Pi 4, and they stopped producing Raspberry Pi 3 for 6 months. So I cannot make my product anymore. And and we had to change the board, because otherwise, next time, we will when they release Raspberry Pi 5, they will stop making Raspberry Pi 4. They don't stop it forever, but because the demand for Raspberry 4 as new board is so big, they just say, okay, 6 months we will just produce Raspberry Pi 4, so we saturate the market, and then we will keep producing Raspberry Pi 3. But imagine if you have a product and you have to stop production for 6 months. That's your customers will go somewhere else. Here is this big variable speed drivers for oil, gas pumps, and converters, which use this obsolete ARM9 chip inside for communication, but they don't touch it for 12 years. It's a huge machine. This one is another customer who is making agriculture tractors, self-driving machines with the GPS navigation, and they buy a lot of A13. A13 is obsolete. It's already not on Allwinner website. If you go to Allwinner website, you will not find trace of A13, because nobody makes tablets with A13. But we have special agreement with them, because if we want to order, they can produce on demand. But the minimum quantity is 100,000 pieces. So we have demand for this. These guys make something like 2,000 tractors per month, which is, for me, is crazy. What they do with so many tractors? But they buy A13 boards, and Allwinner is producing A13 for us. We have already several such orders, custom orders. The funny part is that even people from China cannot order A13 because they don't have project for 100K. So we shipped Chinese chip back to China. So this is what open source hardware is doing. Long-term supply of chips, and even smallish companies which don't use a lot of chips can get supply because of the long-term availability. This one is especially sentimental for me, because the company which do this industrial monitoring is Bulgarian company, and they make something like this, and there is an A20 olinoxino inside. So these big excavators, they every stop costs many thousand euros. So they have to not stop. They have to be monitored 24/7. And if something happens, immediately emergency team has to go there and fix the problem, because a lot of money are lost. So there is a monitoring station which is done with our computer inside, and they put it inside, because most of our customers, what they do, Raspberry Pi are incredible. They create a new demand, new market. They a lot of people get their first work with Linux on Raspberry Pi. A lot of makers do projects with large Raspberry Pi, because they have huge community and they have a lot of codes which people can reuse, and so and so and so. And usually they make something with Raspberry Pi, put it in field, and it fails. And then they start to search for something which works more reliable, and they come to us. So I'm very happy with Raspberry Pi. They create a lot of business for us. These guys also started with Raspberry Pi, but you have here a lot of electrical noise, because these big machines, they work on 60,000 volts. They are huge electro motors which work on 60,000 volts, a lot of noise. So if you don't filter everything on your power supply correctly, it just reboots after a few minutes work, and it becomes very difficult to work around it. This one is, you can see here, olinoxino in a smart traffic light control, and it's put on the streets of Moscow. Another project, but this picture is just illustrative. It's not the product of our customer. They use it in the vending machine, which also operate outside, on the outside temperature. In the one of our other big customers is making handheld cruiser ships point of sales. Also, this is illustrative. I don't know how it looks, but they buy a lot of A20 boards and put it inside this point of sale terminals. And this is not industrial application, but I am very proud, because a Swiss company made a rover on Arctica, and you can see the logo of Olimex. A20 is inside and works at minus 40 degrees temperature. So it was a very cool project. Not industrial application, but still show that it's capable to work at low temperature. So, in my opinion, open source hardware is win, win, win. It wins for you, it wins for your component suppliers, it wins for your customers. Everybody is happy. And it's natural to match the industry customers, because long-term availability, better reliability, because you get the permanent feedback, you can change this or make this better, and your product is improved with the help of the many people. So it's really a good way to achieve better products and to get more customers. And here, the last slide, if you have some questions, we can. Yes?
So how many companies produce your products, and why people choose you?
How many companies produce our products, and why people choose us? Frankly, I don't know. But I'm sure that we have hundreds of companies which reuse our designs. Because sometimes we go on exhibition and some guys come and say, we made a cash register with your boards. I'm sorry. And I say, why are you sorry? Because we copy your design. They say, but we publish it because we wanted you to copy it. There is a business for us. We have enough work, sometimes too much work. But we have enough work to feed our teams and to do whatever we want. So we are happy that people use our technology and we are useful for them. And I don't know, but there is a lot. I know that there is some company in Turkey which published the same. The only problem we have is that sometimes they copy even the silk screen. And there is written Olimex on it. And people, and if it's shitty board, people think, yeah, this is done by Olimex. So this is what I usually tell them. Put your name on your board. You can still say it's designed by Olimex, but produced by you. So if there is something wrong, people know that this doesn't come from us. Yes?
I tried to convince people to do open hardware and open software, and I've got hard times because even if I tell them some like the arguments you said, like the community, the free feedback, the free testing,
yeah,
they think that a Chinese company will rip their design off and. Then they will lose all their customers.
But the question was, I try to convince people to do more open projects and this, but they are afraid that everybody will copy their designs. And tell them that they should not worry. If their product has some value, it will be copied anyway. because I start getting some emails from some Chinese company. They wanted to sell me Raspberry Pis because they see Linux computer and say, but Raspberry Pi is producing is in UK. So they copied. It's not rocket science. People have so sophisticated technologies to copy everything you need. I have seen some weeks ago, an Indian company, which copy every protected chip, and they had a list of thousands of chips. And how it works, you send them chip, and they give you two chips back, and you test them, and you say, yes, they are same like my sample, and then they give you the hex code. How they do, they strip off the epoxy, they look with the microscopes and copy the flash memory inside. So, yeah, and it doesn't cost a lot. It was something like $200 to $1,000. So it was not big investment. So actually, what are you hiding when you don't release your project? They will copy you anyway, but your customers will not have these benefits. They will not have access to the documentation. Even if two products are same, the open product will have more value for your customers because it's better documented and he can inspect it in details. So yes, a lot of people are concerned. Some people make very silly things, like there was some Chinese company which pretended to be open source and they released some board with RT5350 and it's rallying chip. It has data sheet, it has application notes. You can see the radio part inside and everything is published by the manufacturer. And this guy made a board, and because people say, you didn't release like open source, but you claim it's open source, they released one CAD file where they switched the inductors with capacitors in the radio part. I said, what? Everyone who has a bit of knowledge, he will write the application note and see that is bullshit. But you intentionally confuse the small people who don't have knowledge and they will lose money to make aborts and then see that it doesn't work. Why you do this? It's crazy.
Thank you very much.
So, yes, you will be copied. If you are successful, you will be copied. Just look how many Arduinos are out there. Look how many Raspberry Pi equivalents are out there. Actually, Raspberry Pi, the only protection for Raspberry Pi is because Broadcom is behind them and they don't sell chip to anyone else. Otherwise, you will see Raspberry Pis for $10, for $5, I'm sure. Yes?
When you say you're doing some old revision because of the check of not only the big chips that go end of life, but only capacitors, transistors, and so on. The specification, the other word, certification valid?
The question was, when we do the old revision, do we change the capacitors or other components if they are obsolete? It's a general purpose capacitor. If it's 100 nanofarad with this dielectric, with this voltage, there will be no recertification because you just exchange it to general purpose parts. But if you wire the layout of the PCB differently, if you change the antenna or something like this, which affects the electromagnetic compatibility, yes, you have to recheck. But just changing supplier from Samsung to Yaigo or Murata, this will not change the certification. Yes?
How do you handle the FCC and European certification?
That's a good question. How do we handle certification for these open products? We cannot certify everything. Why? Because we have a lot of revisions. As I said, sometimes we make 3 revisions per year. And every time we have to do this revision, we have to apply for new certificate, which costs money. What we did is we certificate the highest runner products. And later, we have a lot of customers which certify their end product. And yeah, if we do this, we help them because the whole certification will be easier and less expensive for them. But we don't do this for every product. For instance, we have ESP32 power over Ethernet board ISO. We certify this because it's a high runner. A lot of people use it. So we did this once so they can benefit for all. But we didn't certificate all the smallish board because we have maybe 15 different revisions. They use the same module, which has all the certificates. And just the surrounding parts is different. And we certify power over it. Much money for something I know. And customers who use these products, they verify and say, yeah, my final products got certificate with these boards. Too many. We have 600 different boards. It's too much and so many revisions. We have to adopt one certification laboratory and they to work only for us.
Should convince your clients to sub-certificate the parts that you couldn't, but that they did, so everyone can actually benefit from it.
That's possible, but I don't want to put restriction in. Yep. Anyone else? Yes?
You talked about in the past about, like, you've gotten back, like, insights from reviews of people, like, oh, you should have hooked up this wire that way to make, like, the SD card go faster. Have you, do you have any other anecdotes of, like, because you're open source, like development model, you get feedback before you produce the board and
yes.
integrate that in.
Yes.
Because you do it in a way that's much more open than most other projects that I know of.
That's a good question. The question is when you should have upload your files if I understand correctly, and to open them. We try many, many different things, but I think the most successful is to open it immediately. When you have the concept and you make the schematic, upload it. Because even it's not PCB layout, many people say, but if I upload it too early, somebody will make copy of it and will release it before me. It doesn't happen like this way. We first board we did this way. We start doing A13 Linuxino, and since we complete the schematic, I put it on the GitHub and block on the web and say, people, we are making new board. Can you check and see if we miss something? And I can see where people landing from to third page. And there was a massive landing from one Russian forum, and there was a discussion there, and they said, hey, should we take this schematic and make a board? Or, and somebody else said, no, forget it. They will lay out, then we will copy it. Too much work. So people are not crazy. They know that you will finish the PCB layout, and then they can access to it. Why should they duplicate your work? So don't worry that you open too early. Actually, you will get the most benefit if you open immediately, because even one IP camera we recently upload, and we forgot the backlighting for the camera for night vision. It's obvious, but when we lay out the schematic, we forgot to put it with the PWM, and some guy said, yeah, you forgot backlighting. I say, yeah, right. What will happen otherwise, you will make a prototype, then you will see that you did wrong, and you have to make a second prototype. So the earlier you open, the better, because you get feedback earlier. So you can make a better product from the beginning, not after a few iterations. We have 10 more minutes. Yes? Are we planning? We have so many projects running that we usually late with all of them. So one more phone project will be too much, I think. Maybe later. Right now, we have a new industrial-grade board, which will be with STM Electronics, STM32. Then we want to make something more powerful, but not based on ROG chip, but based on NXP. They have one wonderful chip, IMX 8 Max, which has 6 core A72 or 76, I don't remember correctly, but they have ton of peripherals. They have PCIs, they have SATAs, they have gigabit, but I think 10 or 25 gigabit Ethernets. And the best is that they can work with the LPDDR4 and can address up to 32 gigabytes of RAM. So we plan to put a connector for laptop memory, so you can put any size of memory you want on this computer, and it will become very handy. It will be not $35, because the chip alone costs 100 euro, but it will be more powerful. It will be ARM server board, actually. Yes?
Will it land in your laptop?
Will?
Will it fit in your laptop?
Not in the current design, because this chip needs a lot of power. You cannot get the power without paying penalty with the power supply. So it's not good for a plastic box laptop, because the current laptop is plastic. It has not a lot of space inside. But we plan to make a new upgrade of the laptop with aluminum body, which can be used like a heat sink. And to put something like this, powerful, it has USB 3. You can check IMX 8 Max. It has a very big range of different devices. It is industrial grade. It works on minus 45, plus 105. And it's totally different from what we have now. Yes.
You presented a few companies that you will be working with. Are these companies contacting you? Are they already aware of open source as a hardware solution, or did you
yes.
do some work with
How
them?
These companies get to the Olimex? Usually this happens. These companies use some Linux solution or something like this, and their employee know about Olimex and influence their bosses to move to open source alternative. This is how it usually happens. No, we are not very popular among corporative brands and things like this, but in these companies work a lot of people. Some of them are open source enthusiasts, they work on Linux solution for these companies, and they say, yeah, there is an open source solution, it has this and these benefits, and they weigh the pluses and minuses of this, and they decide to go with the open source hardware.
Have you already
have
issues with another company creating the same design, but cheaper and kill your sales after that?
We do a lot of new projects. Even if they copy, it will take 1 year to copy it correctly. So we have 1 year window, then we will make something else. And I'm not afraid of this kind of. And after all, I don't want to have all the business of the world. People can eat limited amount of food and can spend limited amount of money. I have a simple life, and I have no ambitions to work 14 hours per day. I want to keep some balance between my family, my work, and I do this for fun because I like it. I will do it without money also. But when people pay you to do what you like, it's even better. So a lot of companies has approached it. Let's make more sales on. Say, okay, yeah, but what's the point of this? More work is more work. And I need some free time to do some interesting stuff which I like. Yes?
On your blog, you were talking about the
STM32MP1. Yes.
Are you planning to make a board?
We already have a board which we are routing now. But as you know, when you read the specs, with the Chinese, it's very simple. They have 20 pages user manual. You read it for 1 hour, and you know everything about the chip. With the NXP TI STM, they have 3,000 pages here. And they have some highlights. And you say, yeah, this chip is so wonderful. And then you start to read the application notes and the data sheet and say, ah, this doesn't work if this is working. Like they say, we have EMC HS200. And we say, yeah, this is faster EMC, good. But later, we read that the PLL cannot work on more than 130 megahertz, so it's not 200, it's 130 HS. And then we see that they spread the signals on three different ports, and to work with HS200, you have to power the EMC at 1.8 volts. But you have to sacrifice all other peripherals on these ports, which is Ethernet, CAN, and many, many others. So there are some things which are good on specs, but when you start to read the data sheet, you see that you actually cannot use them. And this is part of the development process. So.
Yeah. Might there be a RISC-V Linux we know at some point?
This was our talk with this guy. He said, when you will make the laptop with the RISC-V? And for the moment, RISC-V is doing very well. It gets popular. But they permissive licenses like BSD. So take this open source and do whatever you want with it. And actually, the companies which make now RISC-V, do exactly this. They change the instructions to make it incompatible with the other chips. They don't actually open their designs because, yeah, it's RISC-V, correct. But I don't know what is inside. So what is the difference between this and ARM, which also don't tell us what is inside? That you have open instruction set is beautiful, but there has to be one fair, good company, open-friendly company, which to produce chip and open it, everything inside this chip. So we say, yes, we really have completely open chip. Now, for the moment, the companies which make RISC-V chips, they just do it closed source. So yeah, this is RISC-V, but it is not open. Yeah, it has open instruction set. We know everything about the instruction set, but we don't know what else is there on the silicon. So, if there is a good chip which can run Linux and have all these peripherals, I would love to make laptop with this. Or even general purpose computer, because it will be great to have a general purpose RISC-V computer, which even like a Linux Sino in small box, you can carry with you, put a keyboard and monitor and start develop. And our discussion was that, yeah, even if the chip is not so open, it will allow the software developers to work with the architecture and make the software support for the RISC-V. So it will be positive even in this way. And I accept this, yeah. Even if the chip is not completely open, if we make a general purpose computer which has memory, monitor, keyboard, and people can develop on it with a C compiler and to compile toolchains, it will be used well for the software development, even if we don't trust him 100%. Anything else? Yes?
Do you have a particular approach to take care of your customers? Customer says, you say you have 24/7 service at home. Do you have other
incentives? How do we serve our customers? We are a very small company. We are very limited in people. Everything in Olimex is automated. If somebody fills something on the web, there is an ERP system which checks the payments, print the shipping label, and people just put the boxes inside the parcel and it goes away. And we don't have phone support, for instance, which irritates a lot of customers because we have 600 different products and nobody can keep in his own mind all the variation of these boards or how to program them or how to debug them. We have some people calling on the phone and say, I have Atmel name some chip and I want to check if I can program it with. And say, okay, shoot us email or people will check and let you know because I cannot do this on the phone. So, our support is not perfect, because especially for the Linux Sino, we might have three or four people who did, one did the component libraries, other made the schematic, other made the routing, another one wrote the drivers, and when somebody said, I can put this kind of device on the USB and it doesn't boot up, we have to check what is this. Is this device tree or something in the hardware or something with the schematic? We don't provide enough current for this device. So it's a complex thing and we cannot solve it on the phone. Usually we use email for exchange the communication and it doesn't happen immediately because our people has to get the same board from the same revision to install the same software to investigate what happens with this device and to give a competent answer why this happens or not. Yes?
I think you moved from Eagle to KiCad.
Yes.
How happy you are actually with the KiCad?
You know, it's a matter of habits. We first had to move from, I don't remember what it was, CatStar for DOS to Eagle 25 years ago. And or people are saying, no, it will be so difficult. We have thousands of libraries which we have to rewrite. And I say, okay, but we have to get something more modern. And we start using Eagle, and it was not so difficult because you use, in 90% of your designs, you use some components which are 300 or 400. And then you have many odd components. Oh, time's up. People who use it Eagle, now they don't want to touch it because they become familiar with KiCad and now they work with KiCad, and when they have to do something with Eagle, they say, oh, Eagle again.
No.
If you want to make open source hardware, you have to use open source tools so everybody can approach these tools and can contribute. Otherwise, you just limit the number of people who can help you. It's matter of habits. When you get used, yes, absolutely.